time today. I'm happy to summarize some of the research that me and my master's graduate students have been doing. We're looking at the gene expression of this caterpillar based on the different types of tissues the caterpillar happens to be feeding on. In this case, we're looking at the corn earworm caterpillar or tomato fruit worm caterpillar. Obviously, has lots of different common names. It's known as Helicoverpa zea, the scientific name. So you're probably aware that it's a generalist pest that feeds on all sorts of different plants and is a huge economic pest in the United States and other countries. And so we're looking at this caterpillar. It's going to have to deal with feeding on different types of plants as well as different types of tissues. Here it is feeding on silk and fruit and leaves, and then over here it's feeding on the tomato fruit and the tomato leaves. And so that's the summary of what I'm going to focus on in this particular study. And compare it to caterpillars that are feeding on artificial diet. We're considering that the reference diet or the optimal diet will have a lot of plant defenses and things like that. And before I get started, though, I want to mention that a little bit about from the plant side of things. We've done at least 12 different microarray studies where we looked at caterpillars feeding on tomato plants, tobacco plants, corn plants, soybean plants. We looked at the gene expression of them. We've also looked at aphids feeding on tomato plants. We just look at the gene expression of those plants, and so we're interested in the plant defenses because that's how caterpillars would have to respond to those plant defenses. And just as a quick summary, anti-nutrient defenses is the big thing that we're particularly interested in. These are stimulated-induced defenses that we see in plants. And those will be things like protease inhibitors, polyphenoxidase, arginase, threonine deaminase. All these things make it difficult for the caterpillar to digest proteins, and that's a limiting factor for caterpillars when they're growing on plants. If you look at this graph, the red spots represent genes of like protease inhibitors and things like that. They're being upregulated, while blue would represent something being downregulated. So when caterpillars are feeding on plants, they're downregulating photosynthesis in those leaves, but stimulating these protease inhibitors and so forth. And they're doing so more in tomato leaves than in the maize plants, at least in the studies we've done. So chewing insects are really good about stimulating those kind of defenses. And we summarized this work in a few years ago, in the Annals of Plant Reviews in Chapter 5, looking at the transcriptomic response. And then we've also done a lot of studies looking at caterpillars feeding on a wide variety of plants. We're using microarray studies for all this. We have a Helicoverpa microarray chip. And we see that when these protease inhibitors and things are being stimulated in the plant, the caterpillar is responding by stimulating proteases and or turning on other transcripts to try to overcome it and still grow, but it's usually at a cost. So when the protease inhibitors are being stimulated, this has been shown in other studies, as a way for the caterpillar to overcome it, they're stimulating proteases or other transcripts, but it's usually at a cost of the growth of the caterpillar, so the caterpillar doesn't grow as well. And so we see that depending on the plant, those proteases are influenced. The higher the protease inhibitors there are, the more the proteases tend to be stimulated in the caterpillar. So that's a little bit of background information. Again, we did a lot of these studies in our lab, and we summarized these results in Chapter 6 of that same review a few years ago. And so going back to our studies, we're looking at Helicoverpa zea, the third instar, feeding on these different plant tissues. And then we looked at them feeding for 3 days, and then we put them, and then we weigh them and do purify the RNA and do qPCR microarray analysis. And I should mention the fruits come from a different set of plants. While we use young leaves for the caterpillars, so we're looking at very young, fresh leaves for caterpillars when we feed them. Or in the case of the tomato plants, they'll come from the same leaves. But everything was done in a cup, and so the plants weren't being induced by the feeding during the experiment. Oops. And so we do a lot of qPCR and microarray studies for purifying the RNA with the trisome method. We have 20 to 30 replicates. And so this is the first bioassay. This is on corn plants. And so this is the corn fruit, the ear of the corn. And this is the artificial diet representing our optimal condition. And you'll see that the caterpillar growth on the fruit is actually relatively high compared to the leaf. Look how low it is for the leaf and the husk. And the silk is somewhere in the middle. And so this suggested that maybe the metabolism of the caterpillars may have be different between these different host types. For the brevity of this particular talk, since it has to be pretty short, we're going to focus on proteases But we looked at a wide range of genes. We looked at probably 20 or 30 different genes. And so when we look at trypsin, which is a protease, a digestive protease found in the caterpillar, look how highly stimulated it runs a fold sort of way on the leaves. I mean, it's 75-fold higher in the leaf than in the fruit. And the fruit is somewhere in the middle. And the silk and the husk are a little bit higher. And we see the same thing for the aminopeptidase. Look how high it's stimulated in, after the caterpillar feed, you know, in the caterpillar digestive system after feeding on the leaf compared to the fruit. So there's definitely, the caterpillar is trying to overcome those defenses. Or at least the lack of protein or whatever the case may be. Faisal then did a microarray using those treatments. And we have an Agilent microarray chip for the caterpillar that represents around 20,000 genes. Here are myself and some students from the plant animal interactions class analyzing those microarrays as part of their study. Anyway, here is a heat map. And this heat map represents, you know, roughly 8,000 genes that were altered. And the red color represents genes that are stimulated. So if you compare the control artificial diet to the fruit, you'll see that there's a lot more similarity in their expression in these two columns than in the leaf. And if you look at the fold differences, like here's aminopeptidase, you'll see that it's stimulated more so, again, fold difference-wise, in the leaf in comparison to the fruit. So here's our control representing the artificial diet. Or this trypsin down here at the bottom is five-fold higher than in relationship to the fruit. So trypsin is really being stimulated. And then again, we're looking at all sorts of other genes also. Now looking at tomato tissues, we did a similar experiment. Caterpillars were eating on an optimal artificial diet, tomato leaves or tomato fruits. We do our bioassay. Again, this is over 3 days for third instar caterpillars. And you'll see that they grow a lot better on the tomato fruit than on the tomato leaf. And it's really similar to the control artificial diet. Looking at the heat map, we see kind of a similar result where we're looking at the red representing genes stimulated, and using a hierarchical cluster, we see that the genes expression in caterpillars is more similar between the control and the fruit than it is with the leaves. So that, you know, shows that again there's probably a lot more genes being upregulated and downregulated as a result of feeding on a harsher food source. Looking at individual genes again, and again we're focusing on proteases for sake of time, we see that we have 22-fold higher for leaves than the fruit for aminopeptidase. And chymotrypsin, we got 22-fold higher than leaf. Then we had another student do a study where we looked at tomato fruits, tomato leaves, tobacco leaves, soybean leaves, and what we see is the caterpillars grow a lot faster on the tomato fruits than tomato leaves, tobacco leaves, and so forth, the tomato leaves being somewhere in the middle. And again, it's pretty similar to the diet, artificial diet. And then what you see with the proteases is the same phenomenon. It's really high, and trypsin is really being stimulated highly in the caterpillar as a result of feeding on tomato leaves or tobacco leaves, corn leaves, soybean leaves, and the tomato fruit. So in conclusions, Helicobacter grows faster on tomato fruits and corn fruits than the leaves and tissues of those respective plants. In regards to leaves, caterpillars grow faster in tomato leaves than tobacco leaves, soybean leaves, or corn leaves. There's obviously metabolic gene expression that's being altered. We focused on this talk on digestive genes such as proteases, which are highly stimulated as a result of feeding on leaves in comparison to the fruits. And this is probably going to be related to things like trypsin inhibitors as well as the food quality. And then there's a lot of other genes that I talk about, such as growth and detoxification genes, that are altered in response to these different tissues. Anyway, I want to thank my students that were involved. This is Amar, who did the microarrays with tomatoes and caterpillars. This is Kay, she did the corn. And Donald, who did the last project. Thanks to Pat for sending me the caterpillars and Heiko for giving me a microarray chip. And I'm open to any questions if we have time. Thank you. There is differences, but it's more variable based. It's not as clean cut as proteases. Some things are more upregulated in the fruit than in the leaf, so it's more variable. And immune genes and other things are more variable too, but the proteins are